Hello, good afternoon. My name is Caroline Wong, and I first want to start out by saying thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. Vendor security is something I've thought about for a long time. I started my information security career 13 years ago on the eBay Global Information Security team, and at that point in time was on the enterprise side trying to figure out what our vendor security process should be. I then transitioned to the security team at Zynga. After that, I switched over to the vendor side of things, did some product management at Symantec, management consulting for a firm called Sigital, which was acquired by Synopsys. At Sigital, I did a thing called BSIM. BSIM is like an application security framework. I did about three dozen of those. And a couple of years, I joined my current firm, which is called Cobalt. We're a pen testing as a service company in San Francisco. This afternoon, I'm joined by my good friends Mike and Andy. I'll ask them to introduce themselves in a moment, but what I'm super excited about for today's panel is that these folks are real practitioners in the space. Andy, well, I should say probably both of them having been on both sides of this conversation. Right? We're really talking about a sales process. We're talking about a client and a vendor, and what does the security conversation look like between those two parties? I started thinking about this topic about a decade ago, and in 2018, we as an industry have not figured out the way to go about it. It is, from what I've observed, pretty manual on both sides, pretty specific to each transaction. And today we're going to be exploring some of the challenges of this type of interaction, hearing some stories, and getting some advice from folks who've been engaged in this a lot. So with that, I'd like to introduce our two panelists today. Mike?
Hello? Oh, there you go. Yeah, Mike Rodriguez, been in information security for about 15 years, in IT for about 17. Done everything from a SOC analyst to a firewall engineer to pen testing. And yeah, and just really excited to be here. Thanks.
Hey, I'm Andy. I've been in this industry, in the security industry, like the last 7 years, various roles, various places. It's a challenging thing with vendors and security.
So what we've done is we've got a handful of questions that we brainstormed. And we've got two additional questions. But what we thought we'd like to do is, presumably, everyone in this room has come for a reason. There's probably something that you're hoping to get out of this panel. And so the way that we want to approach this is we're going to go through the handful of questions, and then we're going to open it up to the audience. If there are things that you're very interested in knowing, then at that point in time, I'll invite you to come to one of these microphones, and we'll definitely get to some of your questions before we do takeaways. If no one has any questions, which I don't expect, then we do have a couple extras. So let's go ahead and dive right in. Gentlemen, what are the pain points in vendor security today, and how can we improve?
So one of the big pain points from a supplier's standpoint is, you know, just trying to get everybody on the same page. A lot of, like Caroline said, a lot of this process is manual, and there's a lot of redundancy in the work that is requested from a supplier and from vendors as well. And so that's just one of the pain points, is just the redundancy in the manual process of it.
There's also like pretty much no standardization. Essentially, you get, if you're on the vendors or on the vendor side, you want to kind of do deals with some companies. You get 7 different spreadsheets, all kinds of them touch the same area, but ask different kinds of questions, go in the same direction, but still required to draft an answer more than just a yes, no thing. In the end, you end up with like a couple thousand spreadsheet questions on an annual basis that answer the same stuff over and over again. And in the end, you have to trust them anyways.
Can I ask each of you to walk me through an example scenario? Mike, What does that process kind of look like from beginning to end? You know, not necessarily a specific case at Teradata, but just sort of generically, what does that look like when you're on the side of being the enterprise or being the client, and you've got, you know, depending on a number of factors, tens, hundreds, maybe thousands of vendors that you need to learn something about their security? And then I'll ask the same of Andy on the vendor side.
Yeah, sure. So usually, you know, one of the first things you look at and is to try to get some standardization around it. So a lot of the times what I've done is look at the CSA's CAIQ. You know, I send that out to the vendor and say, hey, can you fill this out? What really helps out is when the vendor has that information already on the CSA's website, so I don't actually have to, you know, email somebody, email it to the sales folks who have to email it to their internal team, and then it takes like a month to get filled out. So that's kind of how the process goes. Usually, you know, you get that after a month, and then you review the answers, and you go back and forth with the sales folks and then their security team. And then finally, you come to a decision if you want to proceed with that vendor or not.
And so one question I have is, for anyone in the audience who may not be familiar with CSA CAIQ, what is that?
Oh, yeah, so that's the Cloud Security Alliances. I actually don't know what the acronym stands for, the CAIQ. But yeah, it's a long Excel spreadsheet. You know, has like security program information or questions for the vendor to answer.
And at what point in the sales process does your team typically get involved? Is that presumably someone in the business decides they need something that they're going to outsource? They engage with however many third parties for evaluation. And at what point does security get brought into that process?
Yeah, so ideally, it's, you know, we're plugged into procurement, but ideally that doesn't always happen. So more than normally what happens is, you know, they're already talking to a vendor, they've already gone through an RFP, and then that's when we get brought in, probably like, you know, a month before like final paperwork's supposed to get signed. So that's the pain point.
And is there a lot of pressure from the business side? You know, maybe there's folks in the business who are sort of like, okay, we've made our decision. You know, we want to work with this vendor. Like, hey, security folks, can you just approve us so we can move forward? Is that ever something that comes up for you?
Oh, definitely. Definitely. There's been times where I've received one of those questionnaires, and I think, you know, maybe only like half of it's been filled out, and then the other half is just either NA or just left blank. And I want to get answers to those questions, and you know, the business is like, well, why do you need all that? They filled out half of it. Shouldn't that be good enough? So, yeah, there's definitely pressure.
Yeah, thank you. Andy, what does that look like in your experience, having been in a position of answering some of these vendor security questionnaires, whether it be CSA, CIIQ, or SIG, or VSA, or there's a bunch out there, right? And so maybe that's part of the pain of being the vendor in the situation.
So from the vendor side, this is it's interesting. So imagine the following: you work in a smallish, medium-sized startup company, say around 80 people working there. It's a Friday afternoon. You want to go home. You're pretty much ready for weekend, and then you get a CAIQ in your mailbox with like 680 questions, and the sales guy is like, "Hey, we need to close this deal by today." This is roughly what happens most of the time. So this is the side of you that you have as a small company. So you deal with a bigger prospect, and they want to have all these questions answered. Stuff like, what do you do for physical security in your office? And you're like, we have a shared office with other companies. So you have to come up with some kind of answers to their questions, which do not suit their world always, or not your size of a company yet. And this is the part where you start growing into those questionnaires as a company, but also as a security team, because it's a good outline for you and stuff that you still need to fix. And at the same time, you're repeating yourself all the time again and again. I think my favorite part about it is one question I got once is like, how do you secure your mainframe? And I think it's going to be one of the later ones that we also are going to tackle. But that really made a good time for me.
So our second question is from each side. It seems as though on both sides, there's this time crunch and there can be this volume situation, right? If you're an enterprise, maybe you've got the business knocking at your door saying, we need to close these deals with these vendors so that we can get this work started. On the vendor side, hey, we need to respond to these sales prospects so we can close these deals. What kinds of techniques might you be able to recommend for the audience in order to both prevent yourselves from becoming overwhelmed as well as just sort of be able to realistically manage the workload of doing this while at the same time having a bunch of other responsibilities on your plate?
From the enterprise side, the big thing right now is, shifting left in AppSec or, dev, shift left in the procurement process, get plugged into procurement so that you're there from the very beginning and, the RFP hasn't already selected a vendor and, you have more input into the process. That's one of the biggest things that I can see. I mean, you're not going to really have any efficiencies in because now you're going to have to probably look at three spreadsheets and parse the data there. But at least you're going to have time to actually look at it instead of getting it back on a Friday and the business wants us to sign the deal on Monday. So,
I think from the vendor side, depending on the size of yours, I'm going back to my example in the small, medium startup, is like start having a knowledge base internally. Take those questions, write them down. They come in various variations and shades. At the end of the day, they all ask around pretty much the same topic. Make sure you have this outlined, document this, keep it up to date. Maybe even put it in a spreadsheet. Then another thing is use this as your roadmap for improvements for the future. This is like essentially free security advice you get from the enterprises. They have kind of requirements depending how they're regulated, depending what their risks are. Use this to build up your security posture. Another thing that I definitely can recommend is fill out a standardized form and send it up front to them so they don't even have the chance to send you their spreadsheet. So that means use standards. There's a few standards out there. They're all more or less good or bad, but be proactive about it. Always be proactive about it. If you hear that your sales team is dealing with some bigger company, prepare for that already and give them, here, this is the sheet, send it out to them. Come with security documentation up front. Be transparent about the stuff that you do. I think that is the best part to go here.
Andy, one of the pieces of advice that you've provided for us today is to develop sort of some pre-made documentation as well as a knowledge base. And what I'm assuming is that you find yourself in a situation where you get a form, maybe it's not exactly your standard documentation, maybe it's not exactly what's in your knowledge base, but you're able to copy and paste some percentage of responses. In any given scenario, could you estimate like a percentage, like how much are you able to reuse versus how much do you have to write from scratch again? And perhaps that changes over time.
That really depends on the industry you're dealing with. I would say some industries you can basically just copy and paste 100%, and other industries are really tricky and probably you can reuse 30 to 50%, which is already an improvement to answering the whole thing.
And Mike, the follow-up question that I have for you is with regards to risk ranking. I have to imagine that from an enterprise perspective, there are some vendors and some types of business interactions and transactions that pose a higher risk to the business, a higher potential risk to the business than others. What kinds of approaches have you seen to either take that into consideration or otherwise use that for prioritizing this type of work, that kind of thing?
Yeah, definitely. Anything that involves, payment data, or is a SaaS solution, especially if you're like a you know, like a financial institution that's not really used to working, you know, in the cloud, you know, those are going to be really like high risk things that you're going to want to really focus on. And also like any kind of payment data, any kind of PII, you know, with GDPR now it's like any kind of customer data. Those are kind of like the prioritizations that I would go with.
Yeah. And in the case, say you encounter on a Friday afternoon, you know, a business person, you know, shoots you an email and says, hey, we're going to do this payment thing. Can you take a quick look at it? And if that's the case, as you're both sending out the questionnaire and also engaging with the vendor to try and determine, you know, what their security posture might look like, do you ever ask for more stuff? Like, would you ever ask one vendor for more or different evidence than another based on some of those attributes that you described before, you know, whether it's payment stuff or other sensitive information and so forth?
Oh, definitely. So obviously if it's payment information and it's, you know, you're going to ask for their ROC if they have it, you know, hopefully they know what you're talking about, because if not, then they're already off the table. You know, if you're dealing with healthcare, you're going to be looking for their HIPAA certification. Each vertical has, you know, their particular certifications that you're going to want to look for. You know, one of the things that I always like to just ask for is, you know, especially if it's a SaaS tool or, you know, they're selling me some kind of software, you know, when was your last pen test? And can I get like either an attestation letter from your pen test provider or, you know, some kind of redacted report, you know, just so I can have some proof that you've actually undergone some kind of testing.
Mm-hmm. And just out of curiosity with regards to the pen testing, do you typically just ask for evidence that one was performed, or do you also in some cases ask to see the results of that test?
I mean, obviously, you know, seeing the results, even if it's redacted, you know, they only say, you know, they're only going to show you the things that were fixed or whatever. That's always the best, but you know, obviously there's always pushback. You know, they always just want to provide like an attestation letter that it's been performed. But,
yeah. Andy, what does that look like from your perspective? Can you talk about some of the different cases in which maybe you've been asked for more evidence?
So in general, asking for more evidence seems to be very common practice from big industries. They generally, I have the feeling that the spreadsheet is like the first touch up, and then they look for stuff there, they can start digging around a little bit. Quite often this results in having a call with them, with the security team, and talking about things. A lot of things happen through conversation here as well. Pen test attestation is like the classic thing. This is what we always send up front already. One of the interesting questions is, how often do you do that? Periodically. And they also want to see most of the time that they actually fix the stuff that was found, that it's not just documented. Quite often what happens as well is that, so if you're a company, you're small, you don't probably have an ISO certification yet. You say no on the spreadsheet, and they're going to ask you a few more times if you have ISO certification. This is like circling around because they really want to see that. One thing that is interesting though is once you have the ISO certification, the whole dance with vendor security doesn't get better or easier. It's just now you can say, yes, you have ISO certification.
So that actually goes into a really interesting topic, I think, which is, what's the value of various certifications in this process? And I'd like to ask that of each of you. You know, Mike, when you find out that a given organization has such and such certification, you know, does that make a difference? And then Andy, you know, it's very interesting to hear like, well, if you get ISO certified, it's great. And then they know you're ISO certified, but does it get you any farther than that?
Yeah, sure. So kind of like what Andy was saying, it just makes it kind of it ups the game a bit, right? Because if I see that they have ISO certification, then I'm going to obviously send in, you know, like the CAIQ spreadsheet. And if I see things that are answered no or NA, and they have an ISO certification, I'm going to be like, why? Well, you know, you should really be more mature in your security program if you have an ISO 27001. So yeah, if I see that, then I'm obviously going to ask for more things, more evidence, and kind of dig deeper.
I think from the vendor side, it just helps to tick the boxes most of the time. And it really feels like for lots of the things that you achieve when building up your security program, your maturity program, is a lot of the things are ticking boxes. And I think the actual risk assessment from the vendor side mostly happens then in a conversation with the people. Because this is where you can actually explain why you don't have certain things yet in place for the size of a company. Because there's not one shoe fits all in, this, in the industry anymore.
What would each of you say to a vendor that's kind of dealing with vendor security, maybe for the first time, maybe they're in their first year, and they say to you, hey, what security certification should I get? Will this make my life easier? How would you respond to that question?
Oh, that's a loaded, that's like a loaded question.
Totally.
I would probably say ISO 27001. That's if they're, you know, they're not dealing with any kind of payment or anything. Obviously, if they're dealing with credit card information, then they need to be PCI certified. And PCI is a little bit more prescriptive. You know, you're gonna get a lot more guidance there. But ISO 27001, obviously, it shows that you have a program and you're trying to, you know, part of the thing of 27001 is that you need to do continual improvement. So that's kind of a good thing, right? So, so 27001, just in general, and obviously PCI if you're dealing with payment card data.
Mm-hmm. I first would ask them what they actually do to like understand what their problems might be. And then I would not say do the certification because this is most likely going to stop your business and break your neck if you're a smaller company. But use something like an ISO standard and use it as an outline for a roadmap on things you want to achieve in the next couple of years and see it as your like your guidance system in a way. Make sure that you have the basics covered. You will catch a lot of things on the way that are part of other standards and that are needed for other industries and stuff like this. But the goal is here that you can start already building up your first version of a system, how to manage security in your company. And you can do this layer by layer, step by step, in small steps. And you can do the certification anytime later if you feel like it.
So the next question we did touch on briefly. Why do I need to answer questions about mainframe when I'm 100% in the cloud? So the questions I have for you guys around this is, why does this question get asked? What is silly about this question, and how realistically do you respond?
So essentially, I actually got asked this question twice from two different vendors, or clients in this case. And one thing that really was mind-boggling for me is those questionnaires were huge, and they were covering pretty much everything, from vendors to old AIS machines to HP Unix machines, all kinds of old stuff. And when you look at what kind of company behind it was a very old company. So it seems like they never really updated their risk model to being in the cloud these days or updated their security requirements. And one thing I think is like missing out in the industry in general is like as technology evolves, your standards need to evolve and your questions and your risks need to evolve. And you need to ask the right questions to the right companies and not just come with a machine gun approach on questions here. This question was particularly funny because it was part of a spreadsheet with, I think, 1,700 in total questions that would dynamically be answered based on your previous answers. And that just is an overkill.
So coming from a vendor perspective as well, I think, you know, sometimes it feels like the work is, or the spreadsheets or the work is just being sent, just to be sent. And I think that needs to probably stop. even from my point of view, like, yeah, you know, like I'll send a CIAQ, but I try to be very upfront and say, hey, if this doesn't apply to you, say NA and don't be afraid to explain why. Because I'm actually going to read, you know, your results. And I'm not just going to say if it's a no or an NA that I'm just going to automatically, you know, say, oh, you know, you're not going to pass. But yeah, you know, sometimes it just feels like it's just the process for the process. And that's that. I think that needs to stop.
So that's a great point which you addressed, which is, should there be a concern on the part of a vendor with regards to responding either no or NA? And a follow-up question I'll ask for you guys, which, you know, you can share this information if you feel comfortable doing so. How many of these types of conversations have you been in where the vendor security process happened? Because what I'm hearing is, in some cases, it kind of feels like it's like work for work's sake. So in how many cases would you say, and you can give a percentage, or you could simply say majority, or you could say, hey, I can't answer that. In how many cases does it just go through no matter what someone writes down? And in how many cases does the conversation result in a, well, we're not going to work together because we're not on the same page with regards to security?
I mean, from the vendor side, in my cases, I never had a problem that because we were lacking something or said no or nay to something, that we would not be able to close the deal. Most of the time, we had to have a conversation and basically understand why they are looking for this kind of security measure or control, and then also demonstrate what we do in a way to kind of guard this or cover this or why it's not applicable to us. But definitely as a no-go or a complete blocker, I never encountered this.
And from the enterprise side, I'm not going to say it doesn't happen, because it does, but surprisingly, it's not the majority of things. It doesn't happen all the time. I have seen it happen a few times, I'm not going to lie. And that's usually because, you know, it's a pet project of, you know, a C-suite executive. So. Yeah.
Makes sense. Thanks, guys. So the next one is, I've provided my CSA CIAQ, so why do I still need to fill out your spreadsheet? And I think this question could be generalized to, I provided my ISO, I provided my, you know, fill in the blank here. So what are your thoughts on this, right? Because it seems to me one of the challenges on both sides is that there isn't sort of one industry standard that everyone uses. And why is that?
Yeah, from the enterprise side, I'll be honest, the reason why sometimes we end up sending spreadsheets is because we're involved so late in the process. You get a request to, you know, do a vendor assessment, and it's so late in the process, and you know, if it's a vendor that you've never heard of, you're just going to say, well, I'm going to default to sending this spreadsheet. Now, could I improve that process, or could it be improved? Probably, yeah, sure. We can probably do a little bit more work on the front end, but if we get it so late in the game, you know, it's just kind of you're going off rote, right? You're just sending off something because it's the process, and that probably should be, improved upon. But yeah.
So from the vendor side, I have no idea, to be honest. Seriously, I have no idea. I don't know. But there's an interesting side note. When I started building up our own vendor security assessment system or basic program, I started doing the same stuff that the enterprises were doing to me. Essentially, I started creating a spreadsheet. I put in questions that I thought make sense. I wanted to cover things that fit to our industry, to our risk model. And I started sending it out to our vendors, regardless if they sent me something or not. And it was just part of the process most of the time. Sometimes the people who wanted to acquire or buy into software sent it out on their own already before even asking anything. And so I think the big problem here is the lack of standards, lack of tooling, and that everybody loves their processes.
So it seems like there's a lot of emailing going on, right? There's a lot of emailing spreadsheets. And maybe some of these organizations aren't comfortable posting this type of information online. What's that about?
In general, I mean, posting a security posture online is essentially telling everybody that you do something good or bad, in a way. And I can see why people cannot or do not want to be transparent about it. I mean, just walking around here at the expo is like every second booth tells you, oh, we need to sign an NDA if you tell you about this. It's like, why? In the end, security is pretty much a standard for most parts by now. It's like you do your input controls, you check your data, you encrypt your data at rest, hopefully, and stuff like this. You can put this on a page out there. And I really like companies that have a very descriptive, very easy to understand, very transparent public security page where just can go and see, hey, you actually know what you're doing. You actually put some effort in it. If a company is like, no, we need to sign an NDA and do all these kind of things beforehand, and then we might answer your questions and we probably put NA to most of stuff, that is not a good feeling. So I don't think that people until now realize that using security as an enabler to sell your product might be a good thing. And actually, the transparency there can help you to reach more people, speed up the process, and actually make more sales. Something that we probably as an industry did not figure out yet. We tried to be very secretive about this stuff.
Yeah, and kind of to add on that, you know, nobody wants to air their dirty laundry, right? So, but I think, as Andy said, you know, you can use it as an enabler. I think, you know, a lot of these spreadsheets, they're not, you know, they're not, there's nothing, you know, secretive in there or groundbreaking that nobody else is doing. I think if you, you know, were to have a very transparent page, I think it would help a lot of things. It'd definitely help from the vendor risk management standpoint.
So a follow-up question to this is, if an organization decides to go ahead and write something public on their website about their security practices, certainly Adobe does this. I've seen more and more software companies do this. Do you think that their clients take that at face value and sort of like assume that what's written on the web page is the truth? Do you think that that invites more scrutiny? Do you think that there's any potential for that to invite, you know, potential attackers?
I mean, you can see the internet as a shark tank filled with piranhas. So the attackers are out there anyways, no matter if you have it in a security posture or page, what you do or not. I think it's quite actually on the good side to have this stuff out there. It builds trust with people who actually use your product, who use your platform.
Yeah, I agree.
Cool. I agree too. I just like to ask what I think might be hard questions. So at this point, we've actually got about 13 minutes left. I'd like to spend 5 or 10 minutes to see if anyone in the audience has questions. We've got these two microphones. Fantastic. This is great. This is what we were hoping. So yeah, we'll just do this for a while. And then at some point, we'll need to cut to key takeaways. But great to see that folks have questions for our panelists. So I'll ask if we can start on this
Thank
side.
Thank you. Yeah, I guess it's an advantage to sit by the microphone. I sit on both sides of these. I answer these questions. I request them. One of the things that I'm being challenged with right now is GDPR. And when the vendors that I'm using are collecting telemetry data from my systems, I'm trying to determine how I approach that with my software vendors and the people that are doing that and understanding what they're collecting, because sometimes it's very generic of what they tell us that they're collecting. Have you had any experience with that, or are you attacking that in any way?
I mean, coming from Europe, GDPR is a very hot topic there. We have faced the same problems there. I mean, essentially, everybody tries to tell you pretty much what they're doing, and most of the time they tell you, hey, we use this and that kind of analytics provider and deal with it. I think this is something that is not solved at all at the moment. We need to figure out how to deal with this whole metadata thing, and then at the next part, actually figure out how to delete it.
Yeah, I haven't been in this situation personally, and I'm certainly not a GDPR expert. My initial thought on this is documentation, right? So, you know, to the extent that you can probe a little further, you know, and just get them to write down what's going on. My understanding of privacy at a very high level is that there's a lot of it that's like you have to write down what you're doing, and then you have to do what you write down. So I think that the documentation piece of it and the questions to get to that point seem pretty important.
So we just recently created our own document for sending out to cloud vendors. And the instructions I usually give to the cloud vendors is, you know, have your technical guys fill this out. It's not a pass or fail form. It's just something that we can, you know, translate for our business users to sell them what kind of risk that they have with putting their data in the systems. But then when I get the risk form back and we go through our architectural reviews, it's like, so did these guys pass or fail? And so how do you turn a document that has a whole bunch of, you know, answers on it into a pass or fail document, or is it even worth doing it that way?
I mean, from our point of view, it's never really like a, you know, yes or no answer. It's not a binary answer. It's, you know, going to be dependent on the type of data that, that's being used, you know, the amount of money that we're spending on the provider. Yeah, it's not really like a yes or no answer. It's, I wish there was, but it's not an easy answer. So.
I mean, generally, see it as a work in progress tool, I think. You do not pass this kind of things because code is changed all the time, so it might look different when you get the sheet, actually. In the end of the day, if there's something that is a red flag, talk to the people about it and figure out why this is a red flag and how you can fix it with them. In the end, you want them to you want to work with them.
Yeah, my thought is, you know, whether a questionnaire is 10 questions or 100, there's probably some of the answers that you care about more than others. And maybe some of that criteria can be something that you figure out ahead of time so that maybe each time you're sending out the full questionnaire, but depending on a variety of factors, like maybe in one instance you have a particularly short time frame under which to make a decision. And then you can go to those sort of pre-vetted, weighted, if you will, answers and say, okay, well, maybe we've got 10 questions, but these three are really the ones that we care about, and then dive in. I've also heard some folks say that it's less about the specific answers to specific questions and more about getting a sense of if there is a program in place. So that's something that I've heard from folks on the enterprise side.
All right. Mike, this question is for you. I got to be honest, I was kind of surprised with your guys' answers around ISO and the certifications. I do pretty much the same thing you do when it's going looking at SaaS vendors and their assessment. You know, one of the first things I do is I look at what the certifications are as well as their third-party audits, and I get those reports, you know, with an NDA in place. And seeing if they have that ISO audit, I immediately check off that control node that's there and allows me to focus on the other one, so letting me do my job a lot quicker and then approving the vendor sooner. The other question, I guess the real question I have is, what do you do to validate that the answers that you're being given by the vendor are honest? Because at the end of the day, the only thing you can really hold them to is the contract. And then, Andy, just for you real quick, what do you recommend enterprise clients do when they have these questionnaires for you? I mean, what can we do to better improve that engagement process and help smooth things go along quicker?
So to try to dig deeper, you know, you can obviously in other things, the pen test attestation, but like a lot of the requirements around software development, like you can ask for like if they've done a BSIM or an OpenSAM assessment on themselves. Just asking for more documentation. Obviously, you know, what you said is very true. You know, you can pass those controls off. But a lot of the things is just asking for more in-depth evidence, basically.
In terms of what an enterprise can do to help smaller SaaS vendors, I think standardization is definitely a thing here. If you look at the CHAQ thing from CSA, that acronym is horrible. It's essentially 680-ish questions. This is a lot, and you cover basically everything from the business. I think start small, start with a more pointy 10 questions that are like your interest, and then have a conversation with them and document this, and follow up until they actually have a more mature security program on their side. And if they end up to have an ISO one day, it's great. It still helps you to check this box. In the end of the day, an ISO is just like a thing that tells you you should do it in this way. How you implement it is a complete different area.
Yeah, I've had friends of mine who work for startups come to me and say, hey, you know, we're about to do kind of our first deal with this big bank, and this big bank has just sent me a very intimidating list of questions, and one of the, you know, several of the questions ask for policies, and I'm not really sure, you know, what these are about. And I'll say to them, first of all, I'm happy to give you the 1 minute spiel of what I think each of these are, what they're talking about. But I think one of the things that the startup or the vendor can do in this case is to say, hey, we don't have such and such policy. Can you give me a copy of yours? Because then maybe I can use it. And I think that works for a variety of reasons. Number one, you don't have to either write the policy or pay a consultant to do it for you. Number two, you kind of know exactly what is expected. And number three, I think that sort of shows interest. So that's kind of a little tip that I think can work in some cases.
So I guess all of us know and have consensus that questionnaire doesn't really work, right? It's too long. Most of them are not applicable, and a lot of the answers probably just useless, right? And it could be from an intern who answered the question, right? Which happened before, I'm sure. For larger company or larger vendors, you could ask them for ISO certification, SOC 2 Type 2, blah blah blah. But for smaller startups like Caroline just mentioned, what's the solution? They don't have anything, right? What can we do?
So here's what I think. First of all, I think you should do a pen test, because there's one of the really big differences between a questionnaire and a technical assessment is that you're kind of taking someone's words at face value versus, you know, assuming whoever done this pen test is legit, being able to actually identify potentially exploitable vulnerabilities. So that's like thing number one. Thing number two is that, in my experience, a lot of enterprise customers who want to work with a startup want to work with that startup for a business reason. And so in any type of business relationship, there's like, what value does each party bring to the table, right? So if the startup is providing value to the business that is great, then the startup is in a position to say, look, we really focus on our core business, and we're just getting started in this security area. And I think it's fair to be totally honest and say, we haven't yet chosen to invest in this area a whole lot, if that's the case. Because then you can follow that up by saying, it is, however, very important to us. For you to have trust in us is very important to us. Can you tell me what is the bare minimum that you need me to do? Because then I can plan it, I can make it happen, but you have to understand we're a startup and we're really focused on our core business. Security is something that we're beginning at. And I think that with that approach, which is to number one, be honest, which I think increases trust, and number two, ask for advice about what needs to be done, I think that can be the start of a pretty fruitful conversation.
There's nothing to add from me here. Essentially, one thing is key here, though, is you as an enterprise have the possibility to shape your vendors, essentially, and help them to grow and improve in the areas where you think it's necessary. At the same time, for the vendor, for the small startup, it's a good thing because they get free security counseling, essentially. They get a roadmap and stuff to work on things that matters for the industry and for their customers. This is a win-win situation, essentially, here, if you leave the spreadsheets out.
Just as a quick time check, we've got 2 minutes. I'm not sure if we have another session, but I think if we're super quick about it, we can get everyone's questions answered, and if not, please feel free to come talk to us after the session.
Okay, I'll be quick. So ISO IEC like 27001, 29147, 30111, you know, first of all, what's your favorite? And second, what do you think about like VBSIM or the SAM, or those are the only two that I know off the top of my head.
My personal favorite is the NIST CSF, Cybersecurity Framework. The reason is because I really like the format. I think that these all sort of talk about the same thing in different ways, but I like the way that NIST CSF frames it. I don't know if you guys have other thoughts.
No, I'm a big fan of the CSF. Nothing else to add.
I have no preference, to be honest. It's really whatever helps you. whatever encourages you and empowers you as a company.
Right. So quick questions. So one, InfoSec within your third-party portfolio needs to somehow or another be reported as risk to your business the same as internal, right? So what are KRIs or reporting best practices that you've seen? So that's first quick question. The second one would be, there are many breaches or other events that will show that within a questionnaire, a company has been either misleading or untruthful. What repercussions have you seen, and you know, kind of what is the standard course within your organization?
So with regards to with regards to metrics and KRIs, I think two broad categories that are good in this area are, number one, coverage. So if there's a way to find out, like, how many vendors did our organization interact with this year, and how many of those actually went through an assessment, and then how many of those actually passed. The other, so to say, like, okay, we're trying to do this process, like, did we even get near 100% coverage? I think the flip side of that is to look at incidents that occurred via vendors or that were attempted. So then I think you've got sort of both, like, proactively, what are you trying to accomplish? And then reactively, you know, where did you get hurt?
Cool.
And I think we're done, but thank you so much for your interest, for your participation. Come up and talk to us. Thank you so much for taking the time to be with us today.